Welcome to Beacon High School online video. Topic for today is growing plants. If you look at the plants around you, you will notice that some plants bear flowers and some do not. Flowers have bright colors and nice smell. Some of these flowers turn into fruits. Some fruits like apples, oranges and watermelons have seed inside them. And we sow seeds in the soil from which new plants grow. But have you ever wondered why some plants have flowers while others do not? Or how these plants grow which bear fruits without seeds? So let us study reproduction in plants. Reproduction in plants is done in two ways, either through seeds or through other parts of the plant such as roots, stem or leaves. A flower is the most attractive part of a plant. It has two important roles. First is to attract insects that help in pollination and also to form seeds that will grow into new plants. Parts of a flower. Flower has a following part: petal, sepal, carpel or a pistil and stem. Petal is usually the showy and the most attractive part of a flower. It attracts the insects. Sepal. Sepal are green leaf-like structure that is present at the base of a flower and it holds the flower. It cover and protect the bud of a flower in early stage of development. Next is the carpel or pistil and stamen. They both are the male and female parts of a flower that is involved in seed formation. Carpel is the female reproductive part of a flower and it has a three parts: stigma, style and ovary. Stigma is the sticky one on which the pollen falls. Style is a long tube that connects the stigma to the ovary. Ovary contains ovules, which turn into seeds. Now stamen. Stamen is the male reproductive part of a flower. It has a two part, anther and filament. Filament is a stick-like structure that holds up the anthers. And anthers have a yellow powder called pollen grains. Pollination. Pollination is one of the methods to transfer pollen grains from the male part of the flower, that is the stamen, to the female part, that is the carpel or pistil of the same flower, or it can be another flower of the plant. So you have observed that insects feed on the nectar of a flower. So while feeding on a flower, pollen grains from the anther, it gets stuck to the insect's body. And then the insect moves to the stigma of a similar flower or some another flower. The pollen grains fall on the stigma. In this way, the pollen grains get transferred from the anther to the stigma of a flower is called pollination. And insects are the main agents of pollination as they help to carry pollens from the anther to the stigma of a flower. How seeds are formed? We know that stigma releases a sweet substance called nectar. When an insect sits on a flower to suck up the nectar, it transfers all the pollen stuck to its body and legs to the stigma. After some time, when pollen grains have reached the stigma, they break open and produces a tube called pollen tube. Now this pollen tube slowly grows through the style to reach the ovary. Here the contents of the tube, it get mixes with the ovules and form the seed. The ovary changes now. It swells up and turns into the fruits. And the newly formed seeds are inside the fruits. If the stigma of flower does not receive pollen, then the flower becomes useless as it cannot reproduce. It shrivels and dies. Let us study the structure of a seed. A seed is made up of three parts: embryo, cotyledons, and the seed coat. Embryo, or the baby plant, will turn into seedling or a young plant when it gets the right conditions such as warm, water, and air for growth. The cotyledons. Cotyledons are also known as seed leaves. They store food for the growing embryo till it put out new leaves. Seed coat. Seed coat is the outer covering around the cotyledons that protect the embryo. Germination. Germination is the change of seed into seedling under suitable condition. Now, what is seedling? Seedling is the growth of the new young plant from the seed. In order to germinate, in order to grow into the new plant, a seed needs warmth, water, and air. A tiny hole called micropyle is present in the seed, which allow the seed to absorb water. Now, the water absorbed by the seed dissolves the food in the cotyledons and make it available to the embryo. The food is used for release of energy in the presence of air. Then a small root called radicle comes out of the germinating seeds and it grows downward. It later grows into the root system of the plant. The plumule, a small shoot, it develops into the stem and the leaves. Once green leaves are formed, the young plant becomes seedling. Now it can carry out photosynthesis to prepare its own food. Let us study dispersal of seeds. Seeds need to be scattered to new places so that they have better chances of germination and survival. And this scattering of seeds away from their parent plant is called seed dispersal. And you know that nature has its own ways of dispersal of seeds from the parent plants to other places. Let us study one by one. The first one is dispersal by wind. Some seeds such as those of cotton, madar, dandelion, maple, they have hair that helps them to float in air. So they are carried by wind. Now next is the dispersal by water. Some seeds which grow in water or near it are dispersed by water. For example, lotus seeds. Lotus seeds are embedded in a cup-shaped spongy fruit which floats in water. So water helps in the dispersal of lotus seeds. Seeds of some plants such as those of coconut have a fibrous covering which helps them to float in water. Now next natural way is dispersal by animals and human. We know that humans and animals eat fruits and they throw the seeds away. So now these seeds grow into new plants. Some plants produce burrs and they have the hooks at the end of thorns. Now these burrs get stick to the animal fur and then it can be scattered as the animal move from place to place. Some seeds such as cherry, they are passed out undigested in the dropping of birds. Now next is the dispersal by self-explosion. Fruits of some plants like pea, poppy and bean, they burst open when they are ripe and they scatter the seeds in all directions. So this process of dispersal is called explosion. New plant from spores. Some plants like fern, mosses and mushroom, they do not bear flowers, so they will not produce seeds. Instead of that, they have spores and these spores are tiny powder-like reproductive bodies that are mostly present underside of the fern leaves or underside of the mushrooms. These are not seeds as they are not formed inside flowers. So when these spores get scattered at a place, then a new plant grow from these spores. Vegetative propagation. Producing new plants from plant parts other than seeds is known as vegetative propagation. It means instead of using seeds, we can use other plant parts such as stem, leaves and roots for growing new plants. Plants such as potato and ginger, they grow from underground stems. And potato has buds called eyes. Each bird eye is capable of growing into new plant. Plants such as carrot, sweet potato, turnip, they can grow into new plants from their roots. The leaves of certain plants such as those of bryophyllum produce buds on their margins. These buds grow into new plants when their leaves are placed in the moist soil. Some plants can be produced by artificial vegetative propagation. Now, what do you mean by artificial vegetative propagation? Means using plant cuttings to reproduce plants from the existing plants. For example, rose, sugar cane, they can be grown by stem cuttings. So we depend a lot on plants, so we should grow more of them. Growing crops. The practice of growing plants on a large scale for food or other purpose is called agriculture. Any plants that is grown in large quantity to get food and other useful thing is called a crop. Crops are mainly of three types. The first is food crops like wheat, paddy, maize. Oil producing crops like sunflower and mustard. Then fiber crops like cotton and jute. Agriculture practices. Now let us study the steps should be taken while growing the crops. The first is the tilling the soil. The soil is first made loose with a plough. This is called ploughing or tilling. The loose soil allows air and water to pass through. Ploughing helps the roots of crops to penetrate easily into the soil. Next is the applying fertilizers. Manures and fertilizers are added to the soil to add nutrients that crop would need to give a good yield. Fertilizers get easily mixed in a tilled soil. Next is the sowing seeds. Seeds must be sown at the proper time and at a proper distance. Next is irrigation. Water is very important for the growth of the plants. So irrigation is the process by which sufficient quantity of water is supplied to the crop plants. Then crop protection. When the seeds germinate and the new plants come out, it is necessary to protect them from pest, disease and weeds. Pests are organisms which destroy crops or spread disease. Weeds are unwanted plants. Weeding is done by pulling the unwanted plant with the hand or a trowel, a hoe or a harrow. Chemicals are also used for destroying weeds and insects. Next is the harvesting. When the crops are mature, they are harvested. So this process of cutting and collecting the mature crop is called harvesting. Then storage. Once the crop is harvested, it must be stored properly to prevent development of fungus and damage by pests like rats, moles or birds. So for this, neem is a good natural substance that keep insects and pests under control. So today we have learned all about the parts of flower, seed structure, seed germination, about the growing crops, vegetative propagation and agriculture practices.